One thing I do, forgetting the things that are behind, and stretching forth myself to those that are before, I press toward the mark. Let us then, who are perfect, adopt this attitude. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. What St. Paul is clearly doing here is comparing the life of the gospel, the Christian life, to a marathon. We all live close enough to Boston. We've all seen them running by the hundreds along this long trajectory that you have to train for. You have to be an X number of previous runs before you're even accepted to run the 25 miles. And we all know about the great endurance that it takes. And of course, what St. Paul is doing is reminding the Christians in Philippi. And as an aside, remember, Corinth was the difficult parish. So St. Paul was writing a lot of practical things. And in his letters, we saw in the last few weeks that he's just encouraging them, enter onto the path of the Spirit. Allow God to work within your lives. And yes, it's not something that you can foresee where it's going to lead you, but just do it. And then the rest of the letter is on practical points. Stop fighting over this. Don't do this. Tell so-and-so to get together with so-and-so. Tell them to stop fighting and coffee and donuts after Mass. And that's the whole letter. But in Philippi, as we've mentioned, these people were very close to his heart. They were friends. This was a different parish altogether. These people were trying to do the right thing, and they desired to do it. And we don't have any indications of any kind of internal parish problems. So we notice that in the letter to the Philippians, St. Paul takes them much further, because they're disposed to hear more of the profound teaching. And that's why he says this is a marathon. This is something that is going to take a long time for us to do. Not because it's tedious in the sense of length, but because the work of the integration of our lives is an ongoing process. What we call salvation is not something after death. It's not something which is done once and for all. Once saved, always saved is not a Christian axiom. But that having initiated the path by baptism and the faith, because God's grace had come into our lives, we have to collaborate on a personal level with that grace. And so salvation is an ongoing process. So this is the main theme in this part of the letter. And if you read chapter 2 and chapter 3, it's all about the mind of Christ, which in the letter to the Corinthians, St. Paul just mentions in passing. He says, you have to have the mind of Christ. You must begin to think like the Messiah. Think as the Christ does with that grace. But it's in Philippians that he explains what this mind is. We have it in chapter 2, and of course part of it we have quoted today in chapter 3. And one of the first things he deals with is the Philippians apparently have had a temptation. Like many of the non-Jewish people, the Gentiles, the pagans, who were entering the church, they had a temptation of saying, well, this comes from out of the old law. So we should be observing things from the old law. One, because as far as the pagans were concerned, it was something tangible that you could say. I eat pork or I don't eat pork. I circumcise my sons or I don't circumcise my sons. It's something in a checklist. It's easy. And of course, St. Paul has men following him around the Mediterranean basin, coming in after he's been there teaching and giving a different doctrine. Telling them, you must be circumcised, you must follow these laws, you must observe these things. And so, a number of the pagans hooked onto it. It was something that we could measure. The idea of the mind of Christ of being transformed and transfigured ultimately by grace, interiorly, outwardly, how do you measure that? And so it's more intangible, and so it's less attractive in the immediacy. But if someone wants to tell us to run 25, 26 miles, most of us are not going to go, great idea, I'd love to do that, let's do it this afternoon. There's a very tiny percentage of people who say, well, there's something attractive. I have a friend who did that. At the age of 50, he ran this at 50. He was just one of those joggers. And so, he talked about all the training that went into it and how excited he was. He was from the Midwest, he was from Kansas City. And how excited he was to make all this expense, all of this cost, all of this investment, then travel to Boston, and to do this thing, and to run this exhausting, long race. But he was thrilled by it, and he had prepared for it over years. And St. Paul is saying, that is what the Christian life is. It's not something that we see a tangible benefit right now. You don't get it in the immediate oomph. I mean, we all have heard about the jogger's high. But you have got to train for that, and then you have to be running for a while before that kicks in. And so, yes, in the spiritual life, the initial part is training, it is difficult, it is a collaboration with grace. There is an effort on the personal side of us to engage with that grace that God's initiative has begun with us. God begins it. But we have to be personally, because we are created as free beings, we have to be engaged in it, or salvation doesn't work. It doesn't transform us. And it certainly doesn't bring us to the finish line in heaven. And so as a result, he says, yes, in the beginning it's really hard. And on the psychology of these long marathons, yeah, there'll be a point when you'll hit that plateau. And the spiritual life will not only be ongoing because you've trained and you collaborate with grace, it will be serene. There will be a peace that flows through. But you have to get to that plateau. So as a result, what St. Paul does, and that's the first part of this epistle, is he's critiquing. He's not trying to put them down. He's just telling the Philippians, trying to observe the old law things, that they're not salvation. They were for training. We understand why you want to observe the law, why you want to do these things. But they're done. It's finished. And in fact, you're crippling yourself by trying to observe them. That's why the first part of this epistle, which by the way is written about the mid-50s, it's about 20 years, 20, 25 years after the ascension of our Lord, and written most likely from the prison in Ephesus. The first part of this letter he talks about his chains. So he's probably in prison dictating this letter. And what he's telling them is, look, I've been there. Don't eat this, eat that, observe this, don't observe that, avoid that. I've been there, and he tells them, look, I was trained as a Pharisee. And the tribe of Benjamin, he says in another one of his letters, look, I am a Jew of Jews. I have all of the credentials. And none of it means anything because they were only to lead us to the Christ. And now that I have been touched by the Messiah, more than touched, slammed off my horse and blinded outside of Damascus, but that I have been apprehended, he uses this term, I have been touched by Christ, I have to return that attempt to embrace, to apprehend Christ. So he talks about the initial contact, which is God's grace working in us, and the resulting effect has to be me following after that. And he says the observances, the Sabbath, circumcision, and all that, he says those things don't have meaning in themselves. And they don't bring salvation. They don't bring salvation because essentially they're human actions. They were meant for teaching in the old law. You will circumcise your sons. All right. You either circumcise or you don't circumcise. No one's ever half circumcised. Well, I suppose you could be. That's a little weird. So these observances were all meant to be total human engagements in the old law. They were meant to be completely human activities, of course responding to God's laws, God's directives, but not the question of grace. This was not internal. So that's why he says, look, I did all of these things, and I can tell you, this is not salvation. And then he goes on, we're told. In fact, I consider them all to be lost. They're nothing. And then he goes on and he says, in fact, I consider everything. If you think about being on a marathon, when you're on the marathon, you're thinking about one thing. I'm exhausted, I'm hot, this ground is hard, and I'm trying to hit the finish line and get this done as an achievement. I'm not thinking about my mortgage. I'm not thinking about what happened last Wednesday at the office. I'm not thinking about my exam next Tuesday. I am focused on running this entire race. And so St. Paul is saying it's the same. So that when I consider Christ working in my life, everything from the past I consider to be, and in the lectionary it's beautiful because this morning they translated it by the word rubbish, but in the actual text it says dumb. Everything in my life is just poo compared to what Christ is doing in my life. So you can see what St. Paul is trying to do to these friends of his who are the people of the parish at Philippi. He's telling them, look, nothing in the end really matters. You can't take it with you anyways. Be transformed by Christ. Allow this grace to work and yes, lead you into a path you don't know where, but it's one that's guaranteed that's going to be suffused by divine charity and love and benevolence for us in our transformation. So run, strain forward towards all of these things. So that's the basic idea of today's epistle. But I want to give you, to finish with, what is the marathon point? You know, everyone suffers. We all have pains. We all have disappointments. And we all have frustrations in our lives. It's just part of the human condition. But the difference of Christ's entrance into the world is he transforms pain and death and gives it a meaning of life and resurrection. So that while Christians also suffer just like anybody else in the world, we have a reason of why we suffer. And not only that, that suffering and that pain within our lives is transformative. If we choose it to be so. Now, many people are baptized and have the faith, more or less, who just whine and complain through life. They just go decade after decade whining. And it's a shame because they never understand what the crucifix really means. Why do we have this everywhere? The God-man, the Messiah dying on the cross. It's a reminder that first of all, pain and death and suffering are not definitive. They are not the most important things in our lives. They may preoccupy us because we're in suffering, we're in pain. But they should not be able to allow, they should not be allowed to shackle us. That's why if you look at the epistle that you have in the bulletin today, there are 5 points that I want to leave you with. They're all short, so don't worry, it's not another half an hour. But what St. Paul does is he tells him, what am I doing as I strain towards this goal? And he says, my desire is to be found in him, like an atmosphere. That I breathe the mind of Christ, that grace penetrates everything within me, and that I find the justice that comes from faith. Faith is just that response to grace. And remember, as we talk about justification, righteousness, it's talking about straightening everything out. It doesn't mean that we're better, it doesn't mean that we're wonderful, but righteousness means that we are on a therapeutic, medicinal treatment that is helping us find wholeness, shlomo, well-being, salvatio, salvation. And so he says, this is my goal, to be found in Christ and to find this justice which is of the faith of Christ Jesus. So the 5 points are simple now. The first one he says in this epistle, you can see, is first of all, to know him. Now, most of the world knows about Christ. We all know the Christmas story, even pagans know the Christmas story, and we all know that one day he walked out of a cave, and we call that Easter. Knowing about the Christ and knowing the Christ are not the same thing. And that's why he says, my first goal is to actually know this individual. To know about someone that lives in the street down from you, because your neighbor knows her and talks about how delightful she is, she's wonderful, we just had coffee last Tuesday, and you hear about this woman, normally you'd like to meet her at some point, and a friend will often introduce another friend mutually because of the connection. This is the aspect between knowing about Christ and the difference with knowing Christ. That lady who lives down the street that your friend knows personally, you don't know. You just know about her. And you know there's a nice lady down the street. That doesn't make any friendship, any connection, anything. You just know about her. So the first thing is to know our Lord. That comes by grace and the participation in the divine mysteries and through our prayers. And he says, we want to know him, the Messiah, to know the Christ, because my desire is to know the triumph, the power of the resurrection, he says in this letter. My goal is that. Then he says, the third point is, that I may have fellowship with him in his sufferings. That I may be able to also receive pain and suffering that is given to me and inflicted on me unjustly in fellowship with Christ, so that it begins the transformation of that pain and suffering. As you go out today, remember St. Rafka. Her image is over this door over here. St. Rafka, many of you know the story. She dies in 1914. This is not a medieval story. This is a young woman who in her consecrated life as a nun at one point prays to know the passion of our Lord. And he takes her on her word to know and to enter the fellowship with Christ's suffering. So for the next decades, the woman has migraines continually, she loses her sight, she goes blind, and the last 15, 20 years of her life, she is paralyzed. But because the sisters understand the transformative aspect of the power of the resurrection, at the end of her life, she's in her 70s when she dies, when they go to found a new convent, and they take their little group of five or six sisters who are going to be the core of this new house, they carry with them Sister Rafka, paralyzed for the last years. Because though she can't do anything physically in that convent, she'll never mop the floor, she will never cook for the other sisters, she will never be able to keep vigil praying in the church, but she can pray. And she has tapped into the power of death and resurrection. We take her with us. She's our most valuable member in this new convent. And so he finishes by saying, not only to have this fellowship, point four is to say that I myself may arrive at the point of being conformed to his death. Notice it's point four. You have to kind of get to it, work your way up to that. But that the last one is, so that I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Our goal is eternal life, what we call heaven so easily. But this transformation by the power of the resurrection is the end result of God's initiative, my personal collaboration, then we arrive in heaven. This modern phrase that any dog, Tom, Dick, or Harry who dies, and we all say, well, she's in a better place. Who knows? But by the fact of simply dying, it's just something we do, like breathing and blowing our nose. It doesn't make us go someplace better. We're just dead. Now that's a harsh thing to say in the 21st century because we all want to be warm and cuddly and nice. But the epistle the scriptures, the teaching of the gospel of St. Paul and of the Catholic Church is otherwise. This is a marathon, my friends in Philippi. We engage ourselves to enter into this fellowship, not because we desire pain, but because we desire to transform the pain and frustration in our lives into resurrection and into life. And if we follow this course, this recipe, this diagnostic, this prescription, we are all guaranteed to find the holiness personally that St. Rafa discovered at the beginning of the 20th century. This is guaranteed. This is not a path for 1% of people who train for the Boston Marathon. This is something that all those who collaborate with grace will find in the power and the glory of the resurrection. May it be the lot and the blessing for each of us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.